Yes, my name is Frank Werner. I'm an architect and an urban designer, and I've been working for KCAP for over 20 years on various urban developments. And the last 10 years I've been specializing in the design of knowledge areas, as we call it. But before I talk about these designs, I would quickly like you to tell you something about KCAP. 1989, our office was founded by Kees Christiaanse. We are based in Rotterdam, that's the headquarters. And it was a spin-off from the Office of Metropolitan Architecture of Rem Koolhaas, where Kees was a partner and he started his own office then. And still we operate from there all over the world. The headquarters are projects. In 2005, we opened a second office in Zurich. The interesting thing about this is that we opened this office because we were commissioned a campus design of the ETH in Zurich. It's the technical part of the university, a kind of greenfield campus. And also because Kees Christiaanse was started to become a professor there on the chair of urban design. In 2010, the fourth office, the third office was opened in Shanghai, and we've been operating there mainly on very large scale master plans. And also here we saw, and this was also mentioned before, the development of very large campuses in China, often even complete cities. Sometimes standalone or closed communities. I think it's important to understand for you maybe what drives us, and I can summarize it in four words. We love the city. It's very important to love the city, I think. If you want to work on a campus, it's important to love the city, to understand the city. And we believe in the design of great urban environments that are integral and holistic. It's very important, I think, also for campuses. And we believe in the development of these designs together with all possible stakeholders we meet. And the philosophy behind this goes back to the 60s, and I would like to share this quote with you from Kevin Lynch, which is from the book The Image of the City. And that is that not only the city is an object which is perceived and perhaps enjoyed by millions of people of widely diverse class and character, but it is the product of many builders who are constantly modifying the structure for reasons of their own. And where it may be stable in general outlines for some time, it's ever changing in detail. So only partial control can be exercised over its growth and form. There's no final result, only a continuous succession of phases. And as designers, we have to be aware of this. We cannot control everything, but we may exercise influence on urban development with and through our designs. An important aspect in this is that designing starts or is organizing. You have to interpret many different streams of information, you have to make choices, and in complex plans, in complex urban environments with lots of program, this can become very difficult. So it is not an easy task. Therefore, we propagate a working method that is much sequential. So you start with an analysis, then you do a preliminary design, then you do final design, then you start filling it in programmatically. Maybe you're going to check if it's feasible. No, we think that you should try to work as a designer in parallel streams, multidisciplinary, not only the design streams, architecture, landscape, urban planning, but also, for example, urban economy. It's very important that urban economy is connected to the master planning from the beginning. So, as I just mentioned, since 2000, KCAP has been making nearly 20 designs for campuses all over the world, ranging from inner city campuses, university campuses, to industrial campuses. And working on these campuses, we have learned that there is no such thing as a standard recipe for the design of a campus. Is my microphone giving trouble? We were in the lucky circumstance to be able to do research via the chair of Kees Christiaanse on the ETH onto campus and therefore we were able to also publish this book. It's already 10 years old. It's called Campus in the City, but I think it's still very relevant for today's issues. And in this book, a lot of renowned experts presented and commented on current campus design. And campuses being cities of their own, part of the city, at the moment it's very difficult to predict the changes that will influence its shape and size. For example, how will e-learning affect the size? How will it affect the use of space? Will it reduce or will it increase the amount of building need? Will we need these kind of big lecture halls or even bigger lecture halls in the future when everybody can also follow a lecture on his mobile phone? Therefore, again, as urban designers, we should create sustainable art breeding grounds where existing and new structures and programs, some still unknown to us now, flourish and interweave. We're also a member of IIDP. It's the Innovation Area Development Partnership. It's a new partnership. It consists of leading firms, quite some Dutch firms, on the field of education and knowledge environments. Amongst them are UN Studio, the architect UN Studio, Royal Haskoning, DHV, and Arab. So also consultants, again, in this partnership are working together on the development of knowledge areas. And with EIDP, we are focusing basically on two types of developments, the Science and Technology Park. It's a knowledge and exchange of innovation and business environment based, let's see if that works, based and linked to a university. For example, this one, we made a master plan for this one. It's the Amsterdam Science Park. What is important here again, and this was also mentioned by the previous speakers, is that a network for innovation is created in these spaces that is increasing the wealth of the community by promoting the culture of innovation. What is also characteristic about these parks is that they are managed often centrally by one organization. The other one are industrial innovation parks. Industrial innovation park like this one, it was shown before, the High Tech Company in Eindhoven, are based on a leading anchor company. In this case, Philips. This campus the name Philips is not in there anymore, but the campus was originally the multinational Philips. And these campuses, they are much more about open innovation, about co-innovation between, let's say, the host, the anchor company, and the smaller companies, the incubators, the spin-offs, the startups that are there, companies. But back to the campus, because as previously said, campuses are not only about high-tech clusters, science clusters. They're also about humanities, old universities. So literally, a campus is traditionally the land in which a college or university and the related buildings are situated, including its surroundings. But modern campuses nowadays can be either academic or corporate or even a combination of them. For example, the newest campuses of Google, I think they were already showed, Apple, are examples of this. But if I imagine a campus, I have to go back to when I was 19 If I imagine a campus in a city, and I visited the UK, and I came in Cambridge, UK. And when I saw this, it immediately struck me. I was not an architect or an urban designer yet, but it's a very fascinating, let's say, urban condition, because city, university, landscape are completely interwoven in Cambridge. And this has been like this for 400 years, and it still works very well. And studying this is a very interesting archetype for this relationship between university and city, because the colleges are actually quite cloister-like. They're enclosed and they're dispersed over the city. And the city is basically all in between and the landscape. And if we look at current Cambridge, this is Google, then we see that actually not much has changed and that this also has developed or further into the outskirts. So this constellation may very well be highly relevant for future developments of knowledge institutions, because they form a network of clusters which is completely integrated in the city. I think Willem just already said before, you can look at the city as being a campus, and this is has been done already 400 years ago. So today the campus is in the spotlights of many policymakers, educational institutions and businesses, and many campuses in Europe we experience are undergoing large transitions, especially the campuses that were built after the Second World War. And if we work on it, we have to ask ourselves the question, how can architecture and urban design contribute to and stimulate the social and cultural and economical exchange in and around these campuses, these clusters, in order to everybody benefit from it? To answer this question, we have to acknowledge that there are many different campus typologies. We just saw Cambridge, that's an inner city kind of cluster campus, but there are many more types, greenfield campuses, high-tech campuses, science park, and also the newly erected corporate campuses. If we continue on the, let's say, development of the inner city campus, an interesting example is how it is to look at the next stage of Cambridge, and the interesting thing, this is also Cambridge, but Cambridge, Massachusetts, which is the Harvard campus. And here we see in a more 19th, 20th century condition, the integration of the university and the city. And the interesting thing is here is that at first glance, it looks like a greenfield campus, but in fact, the old heart of the University of Harvard forms the heart of Cambridge, Massachusetts, becoming a centrality of this city. You also see that modern infrastructure can be integrated, whereas Cambridge developed on the scale of the pedestrian. In Harvard, this is not the case. This is a city. But what happened is that the development of the university kept at pace with the growth of the city and the surrounding suburb. And in this way, kind of naturally, a network campus appeared. Not a dispersed system of clusters like we saw in Cambridge, but indeed actually a center of a complete new city. What you also see then happening is that functions that belong to the university start mixing with functions that belong to the city. So academic and non-academic functions develop next to each other and that develop complementary to each other and enhance each other. I would like to show you the project that we are currently working on, and that is not a science park. It's the Humanities Campus in Leiden. And Leiden in the Netherlands is kind of the Cambridge of the Netherlands. In 2014, we were commissioned by the University of Leiden to make a development scheme for their existing humanities campus. And I'll show you a picture of the current campus. You can see it here. On the bottom you can see the Rapenburg, which is the oldest canal of Leiden. And the current campus, which is west of it in this case, on the upper side you can see it. It was designed in the late 70s and realized in the early 1980s on structuralist principles. And today the larger part of these introverted buildings, they do not fit the need anymore of the faculty. They have to be transformed. And the faculty gave us the ultimate wish to create an environment where interaction between people would flourish. So this is not about, you know, high tech. This is about culture. This is about humanities. So also there, the same principle is very important. People have to meet each other. If we look at the city of Leiden, the campus is located on the western part of the rampart, the 19th century rampart, which is being transformed into a circular park. And south of it, you can see a large green space, which is a 400-year-old Hortus Botanicus, which offers a tremendous green quality. The connection of the campus and the city, the historic city, is formed with a 6-meter-wide, only 6-meter-wide medieval alley, connecting the campus to a dispersed network of small alleys, canals, and streets. So you could say that the campus is very well connected. And if you zoom in, you also see that next to the 1980s campus, the old part, the 400-year-old part of the university, is very close in this corner of the city. But what we also see is that all these institutions are very poorly interconnected. In fact, the Hortus Botanicus and the Rampart Canal, they rather form barriers instead of connections. So, first, on a very high level, we tried to suggest 5 interventions that would solve this issue before we start designing the whole plan. And these are very important because they're not only connecting the buildings, but they also connect the campus again better to the urban fabric. First of all, connected to the city, connected to the canal. Make an internal connection between the buildings, the third one. Create an extra bridge over the canal and also connect to the historic part of the city. On the basis of these interventions, different spatial models were developed that all fitted this urban network that I just showed you. And we could communicate these models with the university, with the inhabitants, in order to choose the best one. And after a period of design and also stakeholder discussions of over 2 years, a preferred model was chosen, and that is this model. And the model proposed to create a new public heart in the middle of the site, where there is now a very large, concrete, introverted building. And this new public space, so this is actually about taking space, taking buildings away, creates not only a heart, it also gives an address to all 8 remaining buildings on the site. We had a lot of discussion about public space, and although this space was inspired by the Cambridge courtyard, it is not an interior space, it's an open space. It's a real heart, and it's very public for students, researchers, but also for the people who live there. Here you see the scheme, and of the 8 existing buildings, structures buildings, only 2 have to be demolished to realize this, including all the connections that are there. And the rest can be renovated or intensively upgraded, which also improves the flexibility and, of course, the feasibility of the project. The heart of the campus reunites the 2 parts of the former campus, of the structuralist campus, that were always separated in the form of a square with facilities around it. And it connects directly to this Rampart Park, which then again wraps the whole city of Leiden. So the campus becomes very accessible from its inside out. Oh, I see I only have not a lot of time left. Well, one of the most radical and impressive examples of a university that stimulates urban activity is Belval in Luxembourg. In the late 90s, the state of Luxembourg decided to move the University of Luxembourg partially to a former brownfield location, so a steel factory near Ash. And this location for over 100 years was the heart of the Luxembourg steel industry, and the complex tripled the size of the adjacent village, which only had 40,000 inhabitants. For the site, a master plan was made by Dutch architect Jo Koenen, who introduced a high-density mixed urban environment on the site, and that was based on the industrial structures and industrial heritage. And the university is located on the blast furnace terrace, that's the blue area, and KCAP redid the master plan for the central area. It was in 2011. Very important industrial artifacts, such as chimneys, cooling ponds, and blast furnaces, were integrated in the urban design. And the result, I think, was a stunning combination of old and new structures with intense urban mixture of functions, hotel, housing, university facilities, culture, and exhibition. This is how it is at the moment. So here, instead of a green campus, there was a deliberate choice for an urban and rough industrial setting for the university. The science faculty was designed by Swiss architects Baumschlager Ebele, and the contrasting water elements by French architect Michel de Vigne. Also new buildings like the student restaurants were designed with industrial character, and old coal bunkers remained to serve as picnic areas. Research facilities were built between the restored blast furnaces, and they kind of stand in the middle of the area as industrial cathedrals. The icing on the cake, I think, is the library. This is a bit like this building, but then in Belval. It's going to be opened soon, and the new facade was wrapped around the old steel structure of the smelting factory below the blast furnaces. The last campus I would like to show you is the is a high-tech campus. Nowadays, what I just told is they are located around university, usually beta clusters of university, but they can also be linked to a university. It's the Amsterdam Science Park, where we made in 2003 the master plan for. And it's located around the Faculty of Mathematics and Computer Sciences. We made this design with the conviction that a creative work and living environment contributes to social and economic success, and we acknowledge the fact that scientific and entrepreneurial performance is often the result of collaboration between people from different backgrounds and different disciplines. So you can, it's very important that people can meet. This is how the location looked. The university was there already from the late 1940s. It was a polder, the Watergraafsmeer, and it's completely isolated from the rest of the city. So here we had to ask ourselves the question, can we connect this? Can we connect this site to its surroundings, or should it be a city of its own? And we said, actually, we should first start doing the latest. Here you see a map that we drew back in 2003, which showed the possible end result. Again, this is not a fixed design, but the possible end result of the campus, with around 500,000 square meters of program, very mixed, businesses, offices, research facilities, the university itself, colleges, and also housing. The scheme underneath is actually quite simple. You see the existing situation, the polder, which is closed. We kept open four strips of land in the direction of the original polder. On top of that, there is a slow-mode network connecting all the important facilities and institutions, and there are building zones. Yeah, this is the current situation. Once finished, as I just said, it will contain about 500,000 square meters of offices. What is also important is that there are a lot of amenities, sports, hotel, congress, and around 600 housing units. And we see that here, great mixture of functions, old and new, university, college, research, businesses. The interesting thing here is that the housing is on the right side. It could not be completely mixed because we have all the chemical research labs. The zoning doesn't allow this. This is part of this pedestrian network I just mentioned. It is kind of an independent system that is not designed in advance, but is created once facilities are put in place. Here, for example, you see the route to the faculty from the station, and the paving is conceived as shared space for pedestrians and cyclists. And maybe you can see a little campsite. It's a temporary use on the back. This is the campsite for the freshmen in their introduction week. It's right in front of the faculty. And now that Amsterdam Science Park is over 75% filled, there's already an architectural guide guiding tourists and students, but also inhabitants of the city along the artistic and architectural highlights of the park. So to conclude my presentation, as I mentioned before, there is no standard recipe for successful campus development. However, over the years and within a wide range of projects, I think we can by now distinguish critical spatial success factors that support the knowledge economy. And I will sum them up for you. First is urban facilities, culture, businesses, landscape, very important. The catalytic conditions, it's important that in the surroundings there are, for example, living quarters or business parks. The connectivity is important for all means of transport. You have to be able to get there quickly and comfortably also. Mixed use. Campuses are not only about research or business or education, but they are basically a city on its own. Therefore, it's important to have housing accommodation in different kinds, not only for students, but also short-stay, long-stay concept, apartments, guest houses. Exchange facilities. Cafes, squares, green areas, congress facilities. The ground floor, it's important that the ground floor of the buildings is public and open and transparent and accessible from the public space. High quality and transparent public spaces. I talked about this, I think, in all of the cases. And at last, the tectonic flexibility of the campus, the buildings, but also the urban structure. And this brings us back, I think, at the end, to Kevin Lynch in the 1960s. We cannot exactly predict how the future will look, but we can, as designers, make sustainable frameworks to accommodate this future. Thank you.